Is the increased dietary soybean meal does affect performance during PERS, mycoplasma, hypothermia challenge, and our presenter today is Ms. O'Connell. The others, co-authors are Shear, Schwartz, Riley, Fitzsimmons, and Gabbard. And from Iowa State University, you guys should be mad at me for that one. The Crowley Research Group, and also Sloan Graphics Enterprises. I must be thinking about basketball, right?
Mm-hmm. Go green.
Thank you very much for your introduction. So we will start with an introduction to the topic. Porcine reproductive and respiratory syndrome virus, more commonly known as PERS, costs the industry roughly $664 million per year. The PERS virus is prevalent in roughly 70% of Midwest pigs. This virus increases the chance of secondary infection. The likelihood of co-infection with Mycoplasma hypopneumoniae is extremely high. Today, little is known about how a dual challenge with PERS and Mycoplasma would impact late finishing pig performance and carcass quality. High dietary soybean meal inclusion may be beneficial to these pigs' health. Our study had two main objectives. The first objective was to determine whether dietary soybean meal displaced by crystalline amino acids would increase the severity of health challenges in finisher pigs. Our second main objective was to determine the effect of a late-breaking health challenge on finisher pigs' growth and carcass performance. We hypothesized that the high soybean meal diet will improve the performance during the late-breaking dual immune challenge, which would then lead to improved carcass characteristics. Our study was designed with 96 mixed-sex pigs. They were PIC 359 boars crossed with PIC sows. The pigs started the study at 32 kilograms body weight. There were 6 pigs per pen and 8 pens per treatment. The study had two diets, a low soybean meal diet and a high soybean meal diet. The pigs were immune challenged at 120 kilograms body weight. They were inoculated intramuscularly with a live field strain PERS virus and intratracheally with Mycoplasma. Here you can see the individual diet breakdowns for the high soybean meal and low soybean meal diets. As you can see, the high soybean meal diet contains 6.9% more soybean meal than the low soybean meal diet. The synthetic lysine is also doubled in the low soybean meal diet to account for the lysine requirements in these pigs. The sulfur amino acids, tryptophan to lysine ratio, and threonine to lysine ratio were all kept constant. Now into the methodology of our study. There was a 96-day adaption period, and this was so that the pigs could get from 32 kilograms to the 120 kilograms when they were immune challenged. During this adaption period, they were naturally infected with a 174 wild type strain of the PERS virus. Then on day zero, we inoculated them intramuscularly with a 118.4 strain of the PERS virus and intratrachealy with Mycoplasma. This was done at a rate of 10 to the 3 infected virons and 10,000 CCU respectively. Performance and feed efficiency was measured weekly, and blood samples were also collected weekly. Then on 28 days post-inoculation, the pigs went to market. Lung lesion sampling and carcass data was taken at the time of euthanasia on 28 days post-inoculation at the Tyson Store packing plant. Now if we move on into performance data for these pigs, we can see here that there is a statistical difference in the 22 to 28 day period that suggesting that the high soybean meal diet pigs gained more than the low soybean meal diet pigs. We can also see that there is a tendency in that same 22 to 28 day period that the high soybean meal female diet pigs gained more on the same feed intake. We also see in this table that there is no diet effect on performance in the first 96-day adoption period. If we look at overall performance after they were inoculated, we see here that high soybean meal is represented in black and low soybean meal will be represented in red. We see in these tables that the high soybean meal diet pigs gained more than the low soybean meal diet pigs on the same feed intake, and their gain to feed ratio stayed the same. If we look at carcass characteristics, we see that there is a significant statistical difference that the low soybean meal diet pigs had a greater fat depth than the high soybean meal diet pigs. We can also see that there is a statistical tendency that the high soybean meal diet pigs had a greater lean percent than the low soybean meal diet pigs. This would make sense since the low soybean meal diet pigs have greater fat. In this table, we are looking at the amount of antibody by time point and by treatment. Here we can see that there is no statistical differences in antibody for mycoplasma. However, there is a significant statistical difference that the high soybean meal diet pigs had greater antibody on day zero than the low soybean meal diet pigs. This could be due to the fact that these pigs were pre-exposed to the PRRS virus in their adoption period. We also see here that there is a tendency that the low soybean meal diet pigs had a greater change in antibody for PRRS over time than the high soybean meal diet pigs. This could be due to the fact that the high soybean meal diet pigs started at a greater antibody count, so their change over time was less. When the pigs went to market, lung lesion scoring was done by a veterinarian who was blinded to the study. Although there are no statistical differences, we can see that the high soybean meal pigs had an 11.45% coverage, while the low soybean meal pigs had a 15.89% coverage. This could indicate that the high soybean meal diet is preventing the adverse effects of these diseases. In summary, our study concluded that there was no diet effect pre-inoculation. However, during week 4 of the challenge, the high soybean meal pigs improved both in their average daily gain and their gain to feed ratios. We also found that the low soybean meal diet pigs had a greater fat depth than the high soybean meal pigs. Also, the high soybean meal diet pigs had a greater lean percent than the low soybean meal diet pigs. We may be able to see more improvements in carcass characteristics if we continue to use the high soybean meal diet in a longer study. I would like to acknowledge the Iowa Pork Producers Association for funding our research. And I'd now like to open the floor up to any questions.
Any questions for our speaker?
I missed your rationale on why the low soybean meal had different antibody titers on day zero.
If you look here in our table, the low soybean meal on day zero had less antibody than the high soybean meal, and that was significant, statistically significant difference.
Right, and why was that?
Oh, it was because we think it was due to the fact that these pigs were pre-exposed to the PRRS virus in their adoption period. They were in an industry-relevant barn, and they contracted PRRS themselves while being inoculated. So we think that that could cause their antibodies to be higher.
Weren't they all together?
Yeah, they were, but they were both, they were on these diets in their adoption period. So that could have an effect on it.
Any other questions? These were PIC genetics, right?
Yes.
How did your protein content that you fed, your two different ones, how did that compare with what PIC recommends?
We tried to keep our diet very similar to what we got the pigs from our research group.
Okay, so you weren't, didn't compare necessarily with what PIC was recommending on these genetic lines?
Correct.
Okay. Anybody have any additional questions?
Well, I asked one other student, I'll have to ask you this one. You made comment about changes over time, how did you test that? What kind of statistical test did you use?
So we plugged these into SAS, and we looked at the difference in antibody over the time we averaged.
But you didn't have a specific test that you applied?
No.
Okay. Anything else? Thank you very much.